Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I have a sense we should go out and start in again, because my pages are now all stuck together. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, give unto us the increase of faith, hope, and charity, and that we may obtain that which dost promise. Make us to love that which thou dost command, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
A reading from the prophet Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, sing aloud with gladness for Jacob, and raise shouts for the chief of the nations. Proclaim, give praise, and say, save, O Lord, your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I'm going to bring them from the land of the north and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth, among them the blind and the lame, those with child and those in labor, together, a great company, they shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with consolations I will lead them back. I will let them walk by brooks of water in a straight path in which they shall not stumble. For I have become a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But Jesus holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able for all time to save those who approach God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he has no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins, and then for those of the people. In this he did once for all. This he did once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests those who are subject to weakness. But the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Jesus and his disciples came to Jericho. As he and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." As they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "Teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. The Gospel of the Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. You may be seated. Jesus said, "Your faith has made you well." When you hear or read statements like that, what is the first thing that comes to your mind? This is just one of several challenging statements we've heard Jesus make over the last several weeks. Last week, we learned of the importance of setting self aside and serving others. And the week before that, Jesus said, "The first shall be last," and he spoke of how difficult it is to get into heaven, easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. Yet he said, "All things are possible with God." 3 weeks ago, I spoke to you about struggles, how Jesus often took already difficult lessons and made them even harder, and about how that fact served to emphasize the absolute necessity of God's grace. Today, we encounter yet another challenging statement: "Your faith has made you well." Many inspiring sermons have been preached on this topic. If you just believe it deeply enough, it will happen. That's how faith works, right? But what about those other times? Times when healing doesn't come, or when marriages fall apart, when promotions are given to someone else, or jobs are lost altogether, and financial strain becomes financial ruin. Does that mean that we didn't have enough faith all those times we prayed, begging God for help? Did we just not believe it deeply enough? How is our faith working for us then? Our Old Testament lesson today is part of a lengthy prophecy in which Jeremiah has been warning the Israelites of their impending exile in Babylon. You have to back up a few chapters to get the whole story. But this message of impending doom is also laced with promises that God will eventually restore their broken lives. Indeed, chapter 29 holds one of my favorite verses, and also one of the most well-known of these promises. I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you, plans for welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. But first, Jeremiah warns, life as you know it is going to fall apart. Even so, in today's reading, we find the prophet issuing instructions which seem counterintuitive. He tells them that while they're going through all of this, they should always remember God's promise of redemption, and they should, quote, sing with gladness. No problem. I mean, just keep the faith for about 70 years while you're in exile. So, I have some thoughts on the topic of exile from my own life. February 1st, 2016, I moved back to Pryor. I moved back to Pryor, America. Exile. The move was bittersweet. When I had moved out of my house in Pryor a couple of years before that, I had thought it was for good. I was on to bigger and better things. So when I moved back, it was with an intense sense of failure. My career plans were not developing as I had hoped they would. I spent a good deal of my time being angry and frustrated and, quite honestly, very depressed. A few years previous to that, as I had struggled through my divorce, I had discovered Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you. And it had given me much comfort. But what I didn't realize then was that the promise it contained would become my sustaining mantra. It still is. But during those first few weeks back in Pryor, I reread the entire book of Jeremiah. And in doing so, I was reminded that this promise comes in the midst of a rather depressing message. Even so, the Israelites were encouraged to make the most of their time in Babylon, to build homes, to get married and have families, plant gardens, and to, quote, seek the welfare of that city and pray for it, for in its welfare they would find their own welfare. Ever have one of those aha moments? Not like, aha, I just found a $20 bill. No, this was for me like one of those, oh, I'm pretty sure God just kicked me in the seat of the pants and said, listen, I hear your complaints. Now let's do something about it. Oh, and here's a good place to start. So, I began to seek ways that I could invest myself in the city of Pryor. I mean, I went all in. I repainted my house inside and out. I started planting flower gardens. I joined the local Arts and Humanities Council. And I started attending a quaint little Episcopal church there in town. Over the next several years, my faith in that promise from the book of Jeremiah has unfolded in ways which I never could have anticipated. From confirmation in the Episcopal Church, to serving as their music leader, to experiencing a call to holy orders. That same promise has sustained me through many more of life's ups and downs, too many to delve into within the confines of this sermon. Instead, I'd like to begin circling back to some of those questions I posed at the beginning. My fervent prayer when I first moved back to Pryor was that a job would open up somewhere else, anywhere else. Instead, I found part-time work at my former place of employment. Part-time work gave me the opportunity to rethink the direction of my career. It also allowed plenty of time for my trust in God to grow, you know, trusting Him to provide financially. In retrospect, I now see that even though my prayers had not been answered in the way that I had asked, I might not have come to the Episcopal Church, nor realized my calling to ordained ministry, nor experienced any of the many blessings of being a member of that small parish in Pryor, of being a member of the Pryor community, which I now dearly love. I would have missed all of that. My prayers were not answered the way in which I would have chosen. So, does that indicate a lack of faith? I don't think so. If anything, I feel that my faith has increased because God's answers were not what I had asked. As a result of having gone through that experience, I feel I can stand before you today confident in God's faithfulness. By the way, for those of you who have ever listened to an old Paul Harvey radio show, here's the rest of the story. For those Israelites who were placed in captivity in Babylon, eventually, the Babylonian Empire was captured by the Persians. And after that, Persian King Ptolemy requested that these dispersed Jews compile translations of their holy scriptures. Most of what we have today, and we refer to as the Old Testament, was a result of that effort. God is faithful. Even when we cannot see beyond our own experience of exile or pain or grief, our challenge is to keep the faith. Faith in our sustainer's faithfulness to eventually bring us to a place where we will, like those ancient Israelites, once again sing aloud with gladness. May it be so.
Please stand as you are able and join me in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church in the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, and Polson, our own bishop, that they may, by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. Lord, in your mercy. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. Lord, in your mercy. We beseech thee also to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land. For Joseph, our president, Kevin, our governor, and GT, our mayor, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Lord, in your mercy. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. Lord, in your mercy. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor Barbara Sue, Odell, Nancy, Paulette, Alicia, Jeremy, Marjorie, Shirley, Taylor, Cameron, Finley, David, Charles, Brandy, Martha, the Reese family, Barbara, Heidi, Mary, Vivian, Laura, Mary Jo, Carlina, Barbara, Lisa, Jonathan, Sharon, Michael, Anissa, Marge, Marty, and Chris, and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially Jonathan. beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Most merciful Father, we confess that we have sinned against thee in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in thy will and walk in thy ways, to the glory of thy name. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please stand as you are able. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We have just a couple of brief announcements if you'd like to be seated. All of our events are listed in this little flyer that comes with your bulletin. And today we would like to remind you that Boo Bash is at 5 o'clock out in the parking lot unless we have pouring rain. And if we have rain, we'll move it inside. But I expect it's going to be outside. And if you have your trunk is coming here to be filled, be here no later than 4:30, please. Next Sunday is Consecration Sunday, so if you have not filled out your pledge cards, please do so and bring them back. Our Altar of Remembrance will be the following Sunday, the 7th of November, 5th of November. The first Sunday in November, we'll be commemorating All Saints' Day. And in the pews, on the inside of the pews, there's a red booklet. If you are new here, please fill out the registry so that we can get to know who you are. Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, Creator of the light and source of life, who hast made us in thine image, and called us into new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, All glory be to thee, O Lord our God, for that thou didst create heaven and earth, and didst make us in thine own image, and of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there a full and perfect sacrifice for the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to thee, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, we thy people do celebrate and make with these holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again with power and great glory. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, so to hear us, and with thy word and Holy Spirit, to bless and sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be unto us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, whereby we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies. Grant, we beseech thee, that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and also that we and thy whole world may be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, We are bold to say, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.